Today on Dreamland, Ralph Blumenthal has returned. Ralph was recently on Dreamland to talk about his extraordinary biography of Dr. John Mack, The Believer. Ralph is now out there with an article about our experience and the trouble the media and the government and the society in general is having, facing the fact that given that there are UFOs here, and we know now the government has admitted that they don't know where they're from or what they are, then everyone's having a lot of trouble, except us, making the leap to the connection between the UFOs and what happens to us. Ralph is a distinguished lecturer at Baruch College in New York. He was an award-winning reporter for the New York Times from 1964 until 2009. And so you must have started at the Times when you were about five.
Let's just hope that way.
Okay, we'll say you started at the Times when you were 11. And so, and also that you're weathering really well, my dear friend. He led the Times Metro team. He won the Pulitzer Prize for breaking news coverage in 1993. He was named a fellow of the Guggenheim Memorial Foundation in the early 2000s. And he has also been, of course, one of the co-authors of the story in the New York Times that broke the Tic Tac video and changed the world. So, in view of the fact that you've changed the world, Ralph, how are you doing today?
Very well. Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be on with you. But just a little clarification so that no one thinks I'm overreaching. That Pulitzer Prize went to the Times when I was on the team that investigated the truck bombing of the World Trade Center in 1993, which was the precursor to 9/11, although no one knew it at the time. But it wasn't to me personally.
Oh, I understand. Okay, thank you. Well, Ralph, first let's talk a little bit about Dr. Mack and his struggle, because it relates very much to what is happening now. I really wish he was still with us. It would have been a tremendous help to have him.
You and a lot of other people, Whitley, for sure.
Yeah, and Carrie Mullis, who we'll talk about in a moment, folks, who Ralph and I believe, I don't know if you knew Carrie, I did.
I didn't know him except through his book, but I felt very close to him from his story.
Yeah, well, he was a wonderful, delightful man, and I knew him. We had a great deal of fun together. In any case, the situation is this. 2017 comes along, and suddenly you and Leslie Keene and what was the third author's name?
Helene Cooper.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Helene Cooper publish an article in the New York Times that basically changes the entire discussion about the UFO issue. And now we're beginning to call them UAPs. As Chris Mellon explained to me, that's because they are unknown aerial phenomena, not necessarily objects, which was an interesting statement, I thought. So here we are. You write this article, the experience, the cultural rise of alien abductions and those who encounter them. What do you try to do with it first?
Well, that article was trying to make the connection, a very difficult connection between UAP, UFOs, and alien encounters, experiences, which is a very difficult connection to make because, as you know better than anyone else, not all encounters involve UFOs. And that's something that John Mack noticed too, that frequently UFOs are in the picture when there's some kind of an encounter, but not always. And they are stranger than we can ever imagine, as you would be the first to testify. So that article I did in the debrief was an attempt to come to grips with the fact that while the Pentagon is now saying really for the first time officially and clearly that UFOs or UAP exist physically. They are real. They're not saying anything about where they come from, who's behind the wheel, why they're here, what they want, all these other questions that inevitably arise as soon as you say, well, these things are real. But the government is steering clear of that.
The reasons are possibly fascinating, but before we go to those, why the government is doing this, let's talk a little bit about how things are changing in the culture. You mentioned Carrie Mullis, whom I knew, and he was a delightful, wonderful man. He was the 1993 Nobel Prize in Chemistry winner. And tell us a little bit about his story.
Yeah, he was obviously an eminent scientist who had won or shared the Nobel Prize, which is far more elevated, for chemistry, for finding a way to replicate DNA billions of times so that it can be studied. And it's an interesting story. I believe he recounts how the idea sort of suddenly came to him. It was downloaded into him somehow, which is a very interesting aspect. Not that he hadn't done the preparation for that, but the flash of insight came rather mysteriously. Anyway, the story he tells in his book that you know well, probably from him directly, that bowled me over and that I included in my book on John Mack, was that he had a cabin in Mendocino, California. And one night he went there by himself, dropped off his bags and grabbed a flashlight and went out to do an errand in the backyard, tend to something. And lo and behold, he sees a glowing object, which turns out to be a raccoon, a glowing raccoon. And the raccoon addressed him, "Good evening, doctor."
Dr. Mullis, yes.
Carrie Mullis. And the next thing he knew, he was on the road in a somewhat different location. His clothes were dry. It was the next day. And he had no idea of how he got there. And he had this memory of encountering this glowing, talking raccoon. Right. And then, to make the story even stranger, he got a call from his daughter who said, I believe she had just been reading your book.
That's correct, yes.
He said, well, I've just been reading Whitley's book, too. And then she said she had a similar experience to him. She also found herself in an unexplained location after encountering, some strange phenomenon.
Yes. And she disappeared also for quite a while.
Yeah. And I guess the value of that story is that if this happens to Nobel Prize winners, we can't say that these people are mentally impaired, or that, it only happens to freakish people or whatever, which John Mack, of course, found was not the case. And you know better than anyone that experiences are us. They're just like us. There's nothing that distinguishes them except these very strange experiences.
That's right. And I've often wondered about the locomotion for the denial. What causes it? And I've thought, and I've wondered perhaps if there wasn't someone in the intelligence community who is driving that. In other words, what do you think that they may be actively trying to suppress this?
Well, Whitley, I'm not a conspiracist, and I don't, in all my, work at the New York Times, I've concluded that things don't happen because some, wizard is pulling the strings behind the scenes. It's not as simple as that. To be sure, the government did engage in disinformation and some very shameful episodes of false information that they put out. But it was mingled with some other good information that was put out by other military people and good reporting. So it's a very mixed bag. But I think as far as the government is concerned, the government, I mean, it's not one person, it's a consortium of people, but a group of people decided in the 50s that it was in to their advantage somehow to discredit the people coming forward with these sightings to cast doubt on them, to paint them as communist sympathizers and, you know, mentally unstable or whatever, because they couldn't explain it, among other things. Plus, there was some national security issues that they wanted to protect because they didn't know what this technology was. They were afraid it would fall into enemy hands. I mean, there's a lot of complicated reasons the government did what it did. But I don't think there was one person pulling the strings. We'll never find a memo saying, you know, this is, you know, how we do it and this is what we do. But it was shameful nonetheless.
Oh, yeah. And frankly, it still is because of what's happening now. Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a breathtakingly long break. And during that break, why don't you give up listening to the free show and join us, become a subscriber. We'll be right back. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing: he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today. We're talking to Ralph Blumenthal. His new book is The Believer. His website is ralphblumenthal.com. And we've been talking about the culture and the trouble it's having, basically connecting the UFO phenomenon with the abduction phenomenon. All right, I had to pause the recording for a moment because of a strange sound that I could hear that apparently wasn't going out over the mic. Ralph couldn't hear it. And Ralph, you mentioned when I mentioned, told you what had just happened, the sound has faded, by the way, folks. It was just it could have been the sound of an engine, only the problem was it sounded like it was inside the room. So tell us about what John Mack experienced with this.
Yeah, this very thing used to happen to John Mack when he would be talking in front of an audience. There would be glitches, the lights would flicker, or there'd be, unexplained electronic problems, which I too, by the way, have encountered in some of my talks on the book. And, certainly it's common enough today to say that, certainly there can be all kinds of, signal problems and lapses, et cetera. But it just struck John Mack as particularly interesting, since he was talking about alien penetration of our dimension. And then these things would happen to him. So I've come to sort of shrug them off as they come. And I don't know the answer, but, it happens.
It does happen. And, it's interesting. It could be a reason for it. And that is that magnetic fields might be involved. I know that we had disruptions at our cabin in upstate New York because of very intense free-floating, which should be impossible, magnetic fields. And when there are when this apartment has what I would describe as an electronic fit, I always think to myself it might be something to do with the magnetic field. Recently, I had a missing time experience that started with a power outage here in the apartment, preparatory apparently to my meeting the attorney Daniel Sheehan, who takes an intense interest in all of this. I hadn't seen him in a few years. So there's something there doing this. I have no idea what the 23 minutes of missing time contain. I'm none, but they happened. And that's kind of ordinary in the experience. There's whoever's here wants to hide within our lives somehow.
Right. I believe it was Bud Hopkins who first identified this phenomenon.
Yes.
Bud being, a non-professional who got interested in this field and got John Mack interested. He was an artist, as probably many of your listeners know, a Cape Cod artist, who got very interested from a sighting he had on Cape Cod in the 1960s, got very interested in first in UFOs and then in experiencers, and collected a whole bunch of them and interviewed them and regressed them through hypnotic techniques that he taught himself. Venturing into a very complicated field as a non-professional. But his books were really fascinating. He encountered some genuine mysteries, including, of course, missing time. And I'd be very interested to know if we could sort of part that veil, Whitley, and see what might have happened in that time, if there's any way of zeroing in on that.
I don't know of any reliable way at this point in my life. There might have been a time years ago when I could have succeeded with hypnosis, but that would be when I was much more innocent and uninformed. I wouldn't trust it now. Unless it was very extraordinary, like the first two times I was hypnotized by Dr. Donald Klein, it was like being there. I mean, I was living, reliving things and visually also. And that was pretty convincing. But I'm not so sure that would happen again. And I'm very guarded now, too. I when I try to find someone to hypnotize me, they've always got an agenda. And the next thing you know, they're advertising that they're Whitley Strieber's hypnotist because they tried to hypnotize me for 5 minutes.
Right.
And so, so that's... I don't know how else to do it.
I don't know. It's another part of the mystery. And, one of the famous cases I deal with in my book is Betty and Barney Hill, which was the really first well-documented abduction account in the 60s. And a Benjamin Fine, who was a noted psychiatrist at the time, who had actually done a lot of work with returning World War II veterans, trying to understand their traumas. He became the psychiatrist working with the Hills. And he got a lot of information through hypnosis from them that they remembered some of their experience consciously, which is interesting. But the other parts were wiped out, which is a signature element of the phenomenon. As you know, people have their memories wiped or partially wiped, and they can't recall, but some of it does emerge through hypnosis. And Fine, Benjamin Fine, like John Mack and like you and like me, at the end, we just throw up our hands and say, at last, we don't understand.
Right, exactly. And we don't understand also who this actually is. Like Chris Mellon's explanation for UAP actually is very sensible, because they look like objects and we have debris. We know that because Gary Nolan and Jacques Vallée have studied some of this material and found some very strange things about it that they've both talked about publicly. That some of the material had impossible isotopic ratios in it and things. And I've got a piece of the material here that's been studied enough to know that it's very strange. It was studied at Southwest Research back in the 90s, and we know that it is layered, but there's nothing holding the layers together because you can see them under a microscope. So there is material, physical material, but is this really even a physical experience? I just don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. Because you mentioned earlier people who have experiences and don't, there's no UFO connection between the experience and the person.
Right. Well, you know, John Mack grappled with this because Harvard put him under investigation. I call it the Inquisition.
That's right. They sure did. In fact, Danny Sheehan was his lawyer.
Danny was his one of his two excellent lawyers with Eric McLeish, who had investigated the priest abuse scandal in Boston right at the time he took on John Mack. So with these two good lawyers, and Harvard kept pressing John to come up with proof. And of course, there is no ultimately satisfactory proof, but what there was fragmentary things that were really intriguing, such as the scars that that many experiencers reported seeing after an experience that they didn't remember getting before the experience or having before the experience. And this association with UFOs that many recounted that they saw, you know, a UFO prior to sensing the beings in their room, and the evidence outside, the physical evidence that some real physical object had pressed down the grass, let's say, or broken tree branches.
Right.
So there was some physical evidence, but when it came to the actual documentation of the encounters themselves, that became almost impossible to assemble.
Exactly. There are not many cases where there are external witnesses to an abduction.
You know, I talk about one in my book, which you may be familiar with, Whitley, that always meant a lot to John Mack because he talked about it a lot. This was the case of two girls who had a sleepover. And during the night, the mother of one of the girls went down to check on them and found them missing. And greatly alarmed, she summoned the police and they searched all over and couldn't find these girls. And then a few hours later, they reappeared back in their beds. And later, one of the girls at least, and I think the second one to some extent, recounted seeing a UFO outside the window before this happened. In other words, having some kind of a abduction experience. So this is one of the rare cases where a third party observed the girls missing, which is, you know, really striking. But there were other cases that John Mack studied where people had sensations of traveling, having been abducted by alien beings, traveling through the cosmos, whatever, and being physically present, seen by other people. A woman fainted in her husband's arms and then later recalled that she was traveling, you know, flying into the sky, and he was holding her the whole time. So again, where does that get us? It just more of the mystery.
What happens is very quickly we accelerate beyond the limits of believability. This the strangeness does very quickly. Like I knew an abductee who had been abducted from a subway in Manhattan. And, you know, I would have just discounted that, except that it happened to me when I was a child on a train. So what is it that would make this kind of thing possible? It's as if there's somebody who sees this world more like we would see a game board, and they can move the little pieces around on it however they please. But let's go on now, and I'd like to return to this article in the debrief, which I think is a very, very important article, folks, and there will, of course, be a link to it on the Dreamland show page. Let's talk a little bit about celebrities who are trying in one way or another to normalize this in the minds of the public. We can start with Kendrick Lamar, who you mentioned was talked about it on Howard Stern, that he'd seen a UFO and said he probably thought he probably was abducted by aliens. And then he said a fascinating thing. He said, that's probably what I'm doing music, why I'm doing music right now. You're right. They gave me the energy. And this really resonates with me, and I'm sure a lot of my listeners who are involved in the experience, because that's not just him. That's a huge part of, once you're past the hard part, the abductions becomes fantastically productive. But what happened? Was he willing to talk to you?
No, he was not. Unfortunately, I tried many times through his agent, and not only him, but Lupe Fiasco, another rapper, very famous, and others. And they say what they want to say, you know, on a certain show, and then they won't discuss it afterwards. When, you know, I went after them for, you know, to illuminate or elucidate their remarks. So it was very frustrating for me that I couldn't get them talking about it. But, you know, the purpose of including them in the article was to show that it's not just ordinary people who've had these experiences, so-called ordinary people, you know, non-celebrities. Celebrities have had them too. And, you know, John Lennon had sightings, which he talked about. You know, many other celebrities, politicians, of course, Jimmy Carter. So the purpose of putting that in was just to give confidence to people, ordinary people, non-celebrities, that it's okay to talk about these experiences, to acknowledge them, that in some way hoping to reduce the, you know, the shame, even though there's no real shame involved because they didn't do anything shameful. But that's been the problem all along, that this has been surrounded by the ridicule factor, as you know.
Right.
And that's what makes it very hard to get money for study programs, for the government to acknowledge these things, and for people to come forward. So people who contacted John Max, some of them resorted to the most Byzantine subterfuges, leaving their names with mail drops and, you know, pseudonyms, and because in the end they felt you know, they were jeopardizing their family life, their work. It's terrible.
Yeah, one of the things that our website has a high level of security for its participants because of that, because we have to be very careful that no one can make a link between their actual name and their handle, so that they remain essentially anonymous as if they wish. And with good reason, because people do get fired, the divorces happen. This can be turned into a weapon against somebody all too easily. Still, it's remarkable also, isn't it, that the experiencer community is probably the last group who can safely be bullied in the media.
Yeah.
Sad.
Well, you know, I mean, what you went through after you described your experiences, which were personally very embarrassing for you to recount, if I remember your story correctly, especially for a man to say that these things happened to him, women too, sure. But and then to be bullied over it and to be ridiculed. You know, John Mack took some of his experiences early on onto TV, appeared with them on shows, including Oprah. And it occurred to me, reading the accounts later, what a terrible mistake this was, because these experiences do not lend themselves to, you know, mass entertainment vehicles. It invites ridicule.
Yes.
And they're very strange experiences that really require a kind of sanctity to approach, and a humility to approach, because we don't understand what went on. They really recounting some awful intimate things, and to put that on the air where people can snicker over it is terrible. And that's exactly what happened. And John realized it was a big mistake.
Right. Exactly. And it's because there is a lot of fear out there. I think within the people in the intelligence community who know this is going on and know also that nothing can be done about it, and it's not.
That's exactly right. Yeah. I think that's what's troubled the government, particularly that there's nothing they can do about it. I mean, they would have to admit to the American people, which they basically have been avoiding doing, but it's evident that it's there, that here is a phenomenon that we don't understand that can frustrate our missile technology. Our ICBMs are frozen, and there's nothing we can do to protect the American people. There are objects up there that are literally flying circles around our F-18s and, you know, zooming by and come under the water, which is another particularly strange aspect of these UAP, UFOs, that they operate underwater as well.
Yes.
And the government can't say what it is. So that's a terrible thing to admit after all the billions of dollars we poured into our defense establishment. Gee, American people, there's stuff out there that we don't know what it is and we can't protect you from. So,
especially because, you know, when you scratch the surface of this, it immediately becomes apparent that it's a really a challenging experience and a difficult and sometimes even dangerous. What did John finally come to in terms of the level of threat that was involved in the experience, in the close encounter experience itself?
Well, interesting. He didn't focus much on the threat. He focused on the opposite, on the upside, the messages that were being transmitted telepathically from these beings to experiencers who came away with a greater sense of concern for the planet, particularly the dangers of pollution and environmental destruction. They came away with a sense of community, to use your word, communion with the source or God or, you know, great spirit of the cosmos, spirit of love. John was pretty much alone in hearing these kind of things from his abductees, which is interesting because Bud Hopkins and Dave Jacobs didn't get that same account from the people they dealt with. They emphasized the trauma, which was undeniably there. John didn't deny that, that these people came away really devastated by what they had encountered, as you did.
Yes.
By the invasion of their bodies, their inability to control what was being done to them by these, you know, strange beings, entities. But John got a more positive message out of this, which was interesting. And, you know, some people speculated later that was him. He wanted to see that positive aspect that others didn't want to see, because he was a believer, as my book title suggests, in the positive forces in the cosmos, let's say, or the benign love of the universe, and, you know, all these things that causes that he worked on Earth to better life on Earth, he projected onto the cosmos, that there was a positive aspect to these experiences. But he was basically alone in that.
Well, I have found, and this is true in of many of the people who are on the website, that there's turns out to be a trajectory. In other words, when I first had this happen to me and to my family, it was appalling. I kept at it only because I'm just a stubborn, curious cuss by nature, I guess. But I mean, any normal person would have just run. I mean, you just sold the cabin and gotten as far away from there as you could. But, you know, and especially I had Annie, who understood from the very beginning that this was about contact and communion with something else. And she didn't see it like I did. She didn't see she didn't have the abduction experience either. But then it changes. And there's this trajectory now. I wouldn't trade them for the world. I mean, they're a huge part of my life. So, and that's true of many of the people you're talking to right now.
That is very interesting because, you know, very often we read about the trauma and the night and the nightmarish quality of these experiences and the fear, all of which are real. These people are subject to, as you know, the feeling that they can't control their bodies, that they're a victim, and it's happening to their children. It runs in families. So, yes. You know, people who've had these experiences often see their children talking about the same thing. So that scares them particularly.
That's a shocker. It really is when that happens to you and I've known many people that have had the experience of being very secretive about this and then having their little children come up to them and say, "Daddy, there were little men in my room last night."
You know, this is interesting because one of the things that really convinced John Mack that there was something to this phenomenon, that it was not just, you know, mental aberrations of people making stuff up, which he never believed really, but he was looking for some, you know, confirmation of this. And the fact that children as young as 2 years old who were barely verbal were telling him these same stories really carried a lot of weight with him because he was a psychiatrist. He knew when people were fabricating.
Yeah.
And children, he knew, were not recounting stories they'd read in books they couldn't read. They hadn't seen movies about this. They were very innocent. And, you know, the experience at the children's school outside Harare in 1994, which carried a lot of weight with John and remains an extraordinary episode at the Ariel School, where 60 different children out of 300, 60 children who were at recess, all ages, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11, all told a similar story of seeing a craft land and two beings come out and communicating with them telepathically. They drew pictures afterwards. They recounted this experience on camera for John. And now there's films about it. These people have talked about it now. You know, 30 years later, 25, 30 years later, they've come forward to remember what they experienced as children. But these kids all told a similar story. And again, you couldn't say, well, they all got together and agreed to recount the, you know, a book they had read or something. So it was powerful.
Yeah, exactly. It is probably one of the greatest cases of all, if not the best and most convincing case, but because it was children, it can be brushed aside. There is an article, you mentioned an article from Scientific American. You know, we're going to take our next break a little early, folks, because I want to really get into this with Ralph. So, free dreamlanders, you know what to do. Don't go sit back and get a cup of coffee and wait through the commercials. Go to the unknowncountry.com website and end that part of your life completely by subscribing, because subscribers don't have to listen to them. Although they are lovely commercials, especially the new one. No, the new one about Unknown Country is well done. Anyway, 2014. Oh, let me take the pause.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real.
we can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place. And above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today.
We're talking to Ralph Blumenthal. His website, ralphblumenthal.com. His new book, The Believer, his remarkable and well-done article in The Debrief, The Experience, The Cultural Rise of Alien Abductions and Those Who Encounter Them. In your article, you talk about an article that was in Scientific American in 2014 called Alien Abduction or Accidental Awareness. You tell us a little bit about this article and what it was trying to say.
Yeah, you know, ever since the phenomenon surfaced, scientists have been trying to come up with explanations, and especially, you know, the so-called skeptics and debunkers would, you know, grapple with the idea that, first of all, a lot of these experiences, but not all by any means, happened at night with people in their beds. And so that led some to relate the experience to nightmares, to sleep paralysis, to some, you know, physiological effects where people have out-of-body experiences, all of which are common and documented. And David Hufford, you know, wrote about this in his book about basically the old hag syndrome, where people felt that they were being attacked by nightmarish entities at night, strangled. So there was this article in Scientific American that I referenced where the phenomenon was ascribed to some kind of liminal state where people would get out of their body and imagine these things happening to them. None of these explanations, as I can see, and certainly as John Mack found, really help explain the phenomenon. They're intriguing, but they don't explain all the other things that go along with it. I mean, the fact that the children were telling these stories, that there was fragmentary evidence and, you know, scars and scoop marks and outside disturbance of foliage and grass where a UFO may have landed. And the accounts which don't match. You know, some skeptics try to say that these very vivid accounts of experiences being experimented on or, you know, probed by in pseudo medical experiments, these are just doctor's visits that are misremembered, dentist visits. But the instrumentation that they, you know, recounted being used really bore no resemblance to actual instruments. It's very strange, as you know, from your, accounts of the instruments that was used on you, giant, a box that didn't seem to fit into your body and yet somehow swarmed its way into your body and things like that, don't have any earthly counterparts. So it's not like, oh, this person had a traumatic dentist visit and was, you know, knocked out by, you know, anesthetic and therefore, you know, related this alien experience to that. It doesn't compute. So as good as the Scientific American article was, or as well-meaning as it was, it didn't get us closer to an explanation.
No, it because there is, you know, John, as you point out in the article, split to a degree with Bud Hopkins and Dave Jacobs over the level of material penetration this is. And it's, To me, I see it as a penetration into the material world, not as something that's fundamentally material. Then, can you tell us a little bit about your view of where we are in terms of the actual origin of the experience? Where is it coming from?
Yeah. Well, John, his first thought, having heard about it from Bud Hopkins and looking at the letters that people sent Bud Hopkins, was that this was happening in our reality, because that's what Bud Hopkins believed, and that's what David Jacobs basically believed, that this was actually happening. This was not a metaphor. This was happening in our reality, and Max started off thinking the same thing, but he migrated away from that later on, thinking that because of the absence of proof, and because it's a very wily phenomenon, very strange, that it was happening in some liminal state between our physical reality and something else. And that, as you said, it penetrates our reality.
Yes.
From some other dimension or something else, but it's not just everyday reality. That would be too simple. And again, if it were everyday reality, we'd be seeing it all over. There'd be pictures of it. You could watch people getting abducted off the street. You could, you know, I mean, none of that is happening. It's always happening in some strange way where it can't be proven. And you know, people who have tried to set up proof, you know, Randy Nickerson, one of the most notable experiences, who actually made a film about the Ariel School phenomenon and was one of Mac's first experiencers. He set up cameras with trip wires, and, you know, people have tried all that stuff, and for some reason it never comes out. The, you know, these beings never get captured on film. There's no recordings of them. So that's not just a failure of the instruments to record them. It is something intrinsic to the phenomenon itself. It does not want to be found out. So that's where John sort of split with Bud and David.
I think it's a very hard thing to pin down. Like in this apartment, I have two different brands of security system in the apartment, both with cameras, both. And I have two different brands for the simple reason that the cameras turn themselves off all the time. And there's nothing in the software to cause them to do that. But when I have a particularly deep meditation experience and I feel the sense of presence very strongly, almost always the camera in the room where that is taking place will be turned off during the experience. And I just am at a loss about it because I don't feel that there's a physical presence around me at the time. Huh. And yet the camera turns off, as if the camera could see something that I am maybe unable to see.
Well, you know, there's a very interesting episode in George Knapp's book on Skinwalker Ranch in Utah, which was really is a very strange phenomenon indeed. And they had a lot of strange things were happening there. The portals would open up to, you know, some other dimensions. And anyway, very giant wolves and all kinds of things. Anyway, they talk about one really interesting episode where they had two cameras trained on the landscape, and the view fields of these cameras intersected. So each camera was visible on the other camera. One night, the guts they found the next morning, the guts had been pulled out of one camera. It was completely destroyed. And the other camera, which was focused on it, or that, you know, it was within the field of vision of the other camera, showed nothing happening to the camera that was destroyed. So there's your mystery. Something destroyed that camera, but the other camera, which you know was running normally, showed nothing happening at all. So this is a phenomenon that does not lend itself to measurement.
That has to be one of the great understatements of all time. And right. That is also the core, I think, of the problem that science and the government are having with this. Science can't measure this. The government can't control it. And it's left basically in the bedrooms of the people.
But you know what? A lot of progress has been made with the UFOs and UAP. So within the last few years, they have captured the physical reality of these objects on Navy instrumentation and, you know, military radar, FLIR, thermal imaging devices. So now for the first time, as we discussed, the Pentagon is saying, yeah, these things exist. So that wouldn't have been possible a few years ago when they were still saying, you know, as Jung said, well, these are archetypes or these are, you know, mental aberrations, fly specks on a windshield, marsh gas, all kinds of explanations, the planet Venus. Now I say, no, these things are real. They're physically real. They're objects. They are objects. They show up on image on instrumentation. So now we can say, well, they're real. Well, we can't say that yet about alien beings, entities, whatever you want to call them. But we got part of the puzzle, which is the UFOs. So that's interesting. Maybe they're related. Maybe they're not. I mean, that's as you pointed out, that's the big jump now. Now that we know that UFOs exist physically, what does that tell us about alien beings? And the answer is, well, nothing really yet.
I thought that it occurred to me that if the UFOs aren't connected to the visitors, then there's a very subtle and brilliant deception going on, because they showed up pretty much 10 or 20 years after the first big UFO flaps occurred. People began to see them. And if they showed up and they're not from this universe at all, but the UFOs are, we're going to have a hell of a time getting this sorted out.
Two different things. That's very interesting. We conflate them somehow. We say logic suggests that if the UFOs exist, someone or something must be, driving them. But perhaps not. There's a lot of, and this goes into real speculation, but I saw some of this in Jacques Vallée's new book, and that there's some theory that these UFOs are just extensions of consciousness of these entities, and they're not even hardware. They are constructs of these intelligences that move basically by mind power, which is why there's no visible means of propulsion, and they're just extensions of whatever forces are out there. I mean, this gets really speculative and weird, heavy, but there's a lot of speculation, which is one thing the government, by the way, is not doing. They're saying we don't know what these things are. All we know is that they're real.
I have a feeling that they've been studying this very deeply for a long time, and they probably know an awful lot more about it than they're willing to say. And unfortunately, I think the main reason that they hold back is us, the experiencers, the abductees. They cannot say we were lying about this, and millions of people were affected, often in very bizarre ways and sometimes tragic ways, and we did nothing. We didn't even warn them. They just can't say that.
Yeah, no, they won't say that. And I think, for all the reasons we discussed, the government is not, you're absolutely right that they know a lot more than they're saying, the government. For example, the New York Times, we put up three videos of UFO encounters, let's say, with Navy jets, radar images, images captured by the thermal imaging devices on the jets. And, you know, they've become about the most popular videos the Times has ever put up. They're everywhere now with people, sailors watching it and screaming, oh, woo, wow, you know, look at that, oh, my God. So everyone has seen these videos. But they're only fragments of the videos that the government has. We know that right. We were able to put out, you know, a few minutes, seconds of a video, but there are many more videos and longer portions that we haven't seen that presumably would be more explicit. So we definitely haven't seen everything the government had, and there's been a lot of stuff classified. You know, we in the New York Times reported, we wrote one story about supposed crash retrieval residues, and you alluded to this before, Whitley, that, you know, materials have surfaced of supposed UFO, crashes. So we wrote one story in the New York Times that congressional committees were actually briefed by Eric Davis and others about crash retrievals. Now, we couldn't get much more information than that. And people were all over, you know, the internet saying, why doesn't the New York Times tell the truth, say more? Well, we didn't have more that we could, you know, get on the record. And we, right. you know, we don't use, we didn't use anonymous sources. We use named sources, you know, information we could corroborate. So what we said was that congressional committees were briefed on crash retrievals, and we had some slides actually referring to these vehicles as supposed off-Earth vehicles, the material that was retrieved. But we couldn't find out more about that we felt safe in reporting. So, but definitely the government knows more than it's saying, and hopefully all this, you know, movement for disclosure and, you know, coming out will produce some, you know, further revelations.
I hope so, because it was mentioned in that the classified part of the threat assessment contains 45 minutes of video.
Mm.
And that's remarkable. Now, with regard to objects in that they have whole physical objects, I've known that for years. I know it for reasons having to do in part with my family, and in part with friends who have family who are associated with this or were in the past. We do have at least one intact UFO. And I was queried recently, about 6 months ago, about this. And my response was, put it in the Smithsonian. Hmm. That's what you should do. And the answer was, well, that probably never will happen.
Right. And
it's still true. We should have this is all true and we have an intact object, we should put it in the Smithsonian. That's where it belongs, where everybody can see it.
Right. Well, then, I mean, the government would say, well, the Russians will steal it. The Chinese will steal it, or they'll come and, you know, hack it or whatever. But, I mean, there is a national security aspect to this business, which we have to acknowledge if we're being, you know, straightforward, that this technology, this very mysterious technology, there's a hypersonic craft that can appear and disappear at will, no visible means of propulsion, you know, no aerial surfaces, no wings or tail, no jet plume, ability to operate underwater. I mean, this is extraordinary, represents extraordinary scientific information. We can all agree on that. And therefore, given the state of the world and our adversaries, you could acknowledge that the government has an interest in keeping this as far as possible away from those who would do us harm and use this technology to our detriment, and to use it for ourselves. So, I mean, that is part of it. If there's a craft that we have, and, you know, I've seen the same stories you have, you know more about it than I do because of your family connection. But I've seen those stories. But I can see why the government wouldn't put it on display. I would like them to. You know, by the way, we, the government, knows that the Russians and Chinese are very interested in this field. They have the advantage of operating secretly, given their societies, that their leadership is not as accountable to the public as ours is. So they can operate with a much greater level of secrecy. But we know that they are very avidly pursuing this research. They find it as puzzling as we do. I don't think they're behind it. You know, it's not like we're watching Chinese UFOs or Russian drones. I mean, they are, you know, that's not what it is, you know. So they're interested in it too. And they're rushing to understand it and capitalize on it. If you can use the word capitalism with Russia and China, but they want to, develop this technology, obviously, for military reasons and everything else, commercial reasons. So I can see where the government would not be completely straightforward in announcing everything we have. But I'd like to see more of what we do know.
Well, I think so, too. And I think there's probably a lot that they could release. But I don't think that they will get into the abduction phenomenon and the close encounter phenomenon. And the difficulty is, the more they release of videos and so forth, which they must have extensively. I mean, after all, we have down-looking satellites that must be recording these objects frequently. They must be.
Right. Well, that's a very important element, what you just said, because with all our spy technology in the skies, if we could get a picture of any of these, or if we have a picture of any of these objects coming in to our solar system or even our atmosphere from outside, and you would think, you know, from the space station to all our satellites, to all our, you know, interplanetary probes, if we had a picture of one of these things coming in, we would know a lot more than has already been revealed about the origins of them. So that would be phenomenally interesting. Now, you know, Avi Loeb, in his book about this Oumuamua, this supposed... it was first thought to be a asteroid, but he makes a convincing argument that it didn't follow natural trajectories. In other words, it seemed to have speeded up at a point where suggesting it had a power source, namely the sun, solar power. So maybe that is an example of some object, the first object from outside the solar system that has been tracked, by science. The problem with Oumuamua is that it had come and gone before anybody realized it was here. So we didn't have a chance to observe it very closely, and everything was kind of reconstructed afterwards. But it's a very provocative argument he makes, and yes. He's a very interesting guy. He overlapped with John Mack, by the way, but he and John Mack were like Alpha and Omega. Right. Avi Loeb does not like the human body as an instrument. He likes his telescopes and you know, scientific instruments. He doesn't like the anecdotal accounts that Mac followed so diligently. So they really come from different parts. And we discussed this on a show not too long ago, where he just will not credit Mac's findings about experiencers, and because they didn't come from an instrument that he can trust. So, but what he found about that object is very interesting.
Indeed. In fact, when he was on Dreamland, he pointed out that its reflectivity suggested that it might be a light sail. And I said to him, you know, it's only going 80,000 miles an hour. That is so slow in interstellar terms that if it is an alien object, they had to have released it billions of years ago.
Yeah, he thought it might be a buoy, some kind of a marker in space. Remember, it didn't necessarily fly into our space. We ran into it because the universe and the cosmos and the solar system is in motion. Right. So these light buoys or whatever they are could be just stationed throughout the universe, for whatever reason, by advanced civilization, as you say, maybe billions of years ago, we ran into it. because it stayed put and we're flying around. So, you're right. It's only a fraction of the speed of light. So, which is what you'd need to approach if you're ever going to explore, these other planets that might harbor life.
You know, we have been talking about the difficulty that the culture is going to have absorbing this. And we have a real problem here because the experience itself is advancing and becoming deeper. And yet, at the same time, we are becoming less and less able, I think, to face it, or maybe it's a better way of putting it is the government that it's a big organization. I mean, there's a lot of different aspects of the government. The Navy has one vision, the Air Force, obviously another, et cetera, and so forth. But they're having increasing difficulty with this. Will there come a point at some point where they have to admit that there is an abduction and a close encounter phenomenon, and that they don't understand it? Now, before Ralph answers that question, Free Dreamlanders, we're saying goodbye right now. Ralph's book is about John Mack. Wonderful book, is The Believer. His article in The Debrief is fabulously insightful about why this culture is struggling so with the abduction phenomenon. And we're going to be talking about all of those things, as well as some of the personal accounts that he references in the article, some of the remarkable experiencer accounts that he references in the article, when we get back. Subscribers, Free Dreamlanders, toodaloo. Thank you for watching. Or listening.